You may not know that only two out of the four Gospels that are in the Scriptures tell the stories of Jesus' birth. Matthew and Luke describe the events with a whole lot of variation. Luke, for example, tells of the shepherds and the star, while Matthew alone tells us about the visit of the Magi. Each writer's cultural and religious perspective, who they're writing to, for example, shapes their narrative. Just, of course, as our cultural and religious perspectives guide our reading of the Scriptures. Luke's story is of Mary. That's where we find the revolutionary Magnificat that Mary speaks, the visitation of Mary to Elizabeth, and the in utero meeting of Jesus and John. Luke focuses on Mary, but Matthew speaks of Joseph. Now, Joseph's role in the story is sometimes seems superfluous to us. From the dim background of nativity scenes, he's always kind of standing behind Mary and the baby Jesus. From this secondary position, he fades from the gospel story very early. But Matthew, writing to a Jewish church with issues of law, tells a story with something of a spotlight on Joseph and how he participates in preparing the way for God's light to come into the world. While little is written about Joseph's role, we know that he is dealing with some controversy, both inside himself and externally as well. In fact, Joseph finds himself in quite a jam. He finds himself in a religious legal jam, a personal jam, a moral jam. You see, Mary, to whom Joseph is engaged, is pregnant. And not only that, Joseph is really shocked about this. This puts both him and Mary in social jeopardy. When he finds out that Mary is pregnant and knowing that the child is not his, he basically has two godly choices. First, he could expose Mary for adultery, for which she could be severely punished, even to the extent of being stoned. Or, out of consideration for Mary, but not according to the letter of the law, he could simply divorce her. He could dismiss her, put her aside. Enter the angel into the dreams of Joseph. The message of the angel holds two key directions for Joseph. First, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. An angel calling Joseph to do something that is contrary to the law? Don't be afraid, the angel seems to say. How strange it might seem, but God is in this change, in this shift. Things are about to turn. Will you go? Will you stay the course? And secondly, the angel says to Joseph, and you shall call his name Jesus. You shall proclaim this son of Mary to be Emmanuel of the line of David. Prepare the way by contradicting the law. For me, this brings to mind that wonderful scene that I love from the show Fiddler on the Roof, in which Tevye, the strong Jewish patriarch, sort of, having bent the tradition already to allow his daughters to choose their own husbands rather than participating in arranged marriages, to marry without a matchmaker, he draws the line. He cannot bend far enough to grant his permission to Chava, who wants to marry a non-Jewish man. What could he do? This is absurd, unthinkable. Until Tevye realizes that God has a new word, a new way for a new day. For Joseph, the revelation of God The full revelation of God, as far as he knew, was in the law. And Joseph, as a man who honored this law, was being asked to remain with this one who had conceived in a way unknown to him. Absurd, he would say to Tevye, unthinkable. And then Joseph was to give this baby a name. Joseph, of the lineage of David, was to give Mary's baby a name from his own line, a name that would fulfill the scripture's image of Messiah of all things. To call a baby the Prince of Peace in the middle of such controversy seemed a contradiction to what the will of God could possibly be. But God, he may have realized just this much as a new word, a new way. And if Joseph had been unable to bend, if he had dug in his heels, if he had chosen what he believed to be the path of peace according to the law, his no could have reverberated through history. If he had stayed with his original intention to dismiss Mary quietly, to rid himself of her and this problem, to leave her fate to those who held to the consequences prescribed by law. If he had done this, he would have missed the whole point, that God takes radical steps with ordinary people, steps outside the lines of respectability, in order to reclaim those who are shunned, those who are outcast, those who are accused, and to draw them into the will and way of God, and through them to show the world the light of God. God reveals more truth to show us that the promise of salvation, that is the move towards God's shalom, full well-being and hope and reconciliation with God and all of life. That's what I mean by salvation. That God's promise of salvation lies in following the guidance of the Spirit, even when it leads to the most unlikely places, the most unlikely actions on our parts. That's the message we find in Joseph's example. If Joseph had held to the rule of law, if he had assumed that God couldn't be in such law-breaking circumstances, this new inbreaking of God with us may have been told very differently. If he had simply said with Tevye that the line has to be drawn somewhere. If he had quoted scripture and then closed his heart and his mind to this new and radical thing, God would have had to find a new way. Some of you have heard me tell this story before. Several years ago, a woman that I know, a writer by the name of Mary Jo Cartledge Hayes, wrote an alternative telling of the Christmas story. Her story begins, much as we have heard this biblical story countless times, in the familiar language of King James. But the ending of her story is shocking. And I think her story is that it shows that Joseph's decision about what to do with Mary reveals just how formative simple human response can be in God's doing new things through and in human beings. Unbeknownst to the reader, Mary Jo's story takes place centuries before the birth of Jesus. But the events unfold in an identical way. The surprise comes when the Magi come seeking the Son of God. They come to Bethlehem, and they're told by Mary that they are mistaken about their child's identity. That her baby is not the Son of God, but that her baby is the daughter of God. Well, as you can imagine, in this patriarchal world, that news stuns both the Magi and the reader. When the spotlight shifts to Joseph, Joseph angrily spits on the ground, curses. Curses the angel who had told him about God being revealed in this son of Mary. Disowns the child and departs into the pitch black night. The story ends with the proclamation of another birth, the birth of Jesus, that someone just might say yes to, that is to come. You see, without Joseph's openness to the Spirit, without his willingness to believe that God's revelation in the law might not be the final word, the journey to Bethlehem, at least in the way we know it, would not have taken place. If Joseph had continued his plan to dismiss Mary, if he had not been willing to allow the peace of God to work spontaneously in life's present reality and dilemma for him, if he had opted to be what seemed the obvious right path, if the letter of the law is always the current truth of God, what happens to Emmanuel? How can God be with us in each present moment if God has already told us the way it's going to be till the end of time? How could God possibly be relevant and vibrant and vital in the ways of centuries past when human cultural evolution and science and even theology has revealed so much more of who God is and the potential of God to work in human life? If Joseph had chosen to dig in his heels and insist that what was once God's way is always so, would he have missed the presence of God there in the manger? Sure, Joseph's life might have been easier if he had dismissed Mary and this whole messiness and the possibility that his own character would be impugned. It would have been safer for him if he had dealt with and yielded to the peace of reason rather than the peace that was promised if he would take this risky path. Isn't life easier? Easier to navigate with clear rules that are simple, defined, never changing? Wouldn't it be easier if we just knew what God expected from us, if nothing were relative? If we could find boxes in which to fit ourselves and God. If we had a formula, maybe this would be good. If we had a formula for creating peaceful spirits and a peaceful world, if we could hold ourselves and others to these prescribed behaviors, then maybe we would be all right. But that's not how the world is. And my friends, that's not how God is. What wonder and grace we would stand to miss if everything were written in stone for all time. What miracles in the straw. What wonder for humanity. What healing, what freedom, what God with us and in us. What new emerging truth or thought or hope or God would we miss if we dismiss the uncomfortable and unthinkable or a new holy notion. And Joseph took a deep breath when he contemplated what the angel had said, when he mustered his courage and dared to hope that the angel just might be reliable, when he could remember the promise of the prophets who spoke of God's anointed one who would be Emmanuel, God with us. He grew willing to adopt the scandal as his own, to choose the way that appeared to be the way of upheaval and chaos. He dared to take this new thing that God was doing and cradle it in his own arms and risk his own life for it. When he did this, rather than dismiss Mary, God was known in a way that not only shook his own life, but shook the whole world. The Word of God was made flesh and dwelt among us. this new thing, this Emmanuel, God with us, Prince of Peace, maybe waiting to be born again, to come out of nowhere, to call us to something unreasonable, to speak in the most unlikely voice. And so we're in the Joseph dilemma. Do we dismiss what we see, what we hear, what may resonate as good and holy? Do we resonate with it because it isn't what we always thought was God's way? Or will we too walk the Joseph path, refusing to dismiss what is unheard of, to experience the ever new, still speaking, vitally alive presence of God? Will we allow the work of God to burst through our most protected places, our most immovable theologies, our beyond questioning expectations? The world is about to turn. Mary knew it. She felt it in her body. And she sang of a new world where the lowly would be lifted up and the arrogant would be put down. Joseph knew it. He knew the world was about to turn. He knew that God was doing a new thing, and he said yes. My friends, the world is about to turn. It's turning as we sit and listen. Sometimes we think that bringing peace to the world is way too much for us. Bringing hope and love and kindness to places of cruelty and war is way more than we can do. But Mary shows us, and Joseph shows us, that what we need to do is show up, open our hearts wide for God to do a new thing, and say yes. Yes, I'll help birth it, I'll receive it, and we will have, and we will know God with us in wondrous new ways. May it be so. Alone tells us about the visit of the Magi. Each writer's cultural and religious perspective, who they're writing to, for example, shapes their narrative. Just, of course, as our cultural and religious perspectives guide our reading of the scriptures. Luke's story is of Mary. That's where we find the revolutionary Magnificat that Mary speaks. The visitation of Mary to Elizabeth, and the in utero meeting of Jesus and John. Luke focuses on Mary, but Matthew speaks of Joseph. Now, Joseph's role in the story is sometimes seems superfluous to us. From the dim background of nativity scenes, he's always kind of standing behind Mary and the baby Jesus. From this secondary position, he fades from the gospel story very early. But Matthew, writing to a Jewish church with issues of law, tells a story with something of a spotlight on Joseph and how he participates in preparing. You may not know that only two out of the four Gospels that are in the scriptures tell the stories of Jesus' birth. Matthew and Luke describe the events with a whole lot of variation. Luke, for example, tells of the shepherds and the star, while Matthew, when he finds out that Mary is pregnant and knowing that the child is not his, he basically has two godly choices. First, he could expose Mary for adultery, for which she could be severely punished, even to the extent of being stoned, or out of consideration for Mary, but not according to the letter of the law, he could simply divorce her. He could dismiss her, put her aside. Enter the angel into the dream, the way for God's light to come into the world. While little is written about Joseph's role, we know that he is dealing with some controversy, both inside himself and externally as well. In fact, Joseph finds himself in quite a jam. He finds himself in a religious legal jam, a personal jam, a moral jam. You see, Mary, to whom Joseph is engaged, is pregnant. And not only that, Joseph is really shocked about this. This puts both him and Mary in social jeopardy.